And it's a good day, We talk about teamwork, and thank you for the team. Because we got the music together. Took us a little bit, but we worked together and everything worked out. So I hope that everybody has some music, because the PowerPoint is coming today. And one day I will share why. Got some little notes here. Of course, everybody was handed the SISI update from our missionaries in Latin America. So printed one of those off for everybody to have a look at and to read and to see how they're ministering down there. And just good news about what is happening there after the COVID and how they're able to reach out. Also got a thank you from Project Share for their coldest night in the year. But there's also a thank you to us and to the Lutheran Church for being generous supporters of their mission there at Project Share. So I'm going to hang this on the back so that you can read it if you would like to. But also they are having, and it is cold out there. I was saying to somebody the other day, I can't imagine being homeless. It's minus 30, minus 25. Degree temperature, so this is, it's cold out there, and it is cold out there, but they're having a goal to raise 50,000 by February 25th, so they're looking for teens of all shapes, sizes, and ages who will recruit friends to their team with a goal of raising $1,000 per team, and this is a walk, let me see, when is it going to take place? On February 25th, but where? That. Yeah, I don't see where they are going to meet. So, did you get any information, CM?
It's usually in one of the areas within the city. I have walked with them before, and it's cold.
Warmly, okay.
But it is for an important cause. It's a their fundraiser. It's an important thing.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. So hopefully they will let you know where to meet. I've never participated in this, but CN has. So if you wish to participate in that, then let's talk about it. It's going to be February 25th very soon. So if we want to do something like that, then we do need to do that very quickly. The only other announcement that I had was that Carrie has some announcements.
Well, I want to say that from my vantage point this morning, the ship is tipping this way a little bit. So, sorry. Anyways, no stress to the people that are in this section, but you're going to have to sing right out because these guys are going to get you. They're going to overpower you. So anyways, we'll all join our voices regardless. That was not my announcement. My announcement is that the Wednesday night house group has just started a study on, it's called Life Lessons from Daniel and Esther, which are the two characters from the Old Testament, two great stories, two great books of the Bible. And one of the things that we were committing ourselves to during our house group is praying individually or for families in our church. So if you receive a card in the mail from the Wednesday night house group with all of our names in it, it means that we have prayed for you. So I just wanted to let you know that if you thought that was something like, why is the Wednesday night house group sending me a card? It's because we have prayed for you at our most recent meeting. So that was one thing. I just didn't want anybody to be wondering why they're getting a card from the Wednesday night house group. The next announcement I have is that I have set up three times to meet here in the church in once in March, once in April, and once in May on a Wednesday evening. And that Wednesday evening will be devoted strictly to a peaceful gathering. And when I mean peaceful gathering, I mean allowing ourselves to hopefully find peace in prayer, peace in the stillness of the sanctuary. So there will be no few lights. There will be quiet music. There will be candles, and there will be times of reflection. There will be times to listen to some scripture, and you can participate, or you can simply just be there and find peace. So I wanted to put that out there for now, and there will be more information coming on that.
Okay, well, thank you, Carrie. I think that that is going to be a wonderful night for our church. So keep your eyes posted for those dates that will be put into print for you as well. And just to remind you that we are having coffee time at Williams tomorrow and my Bible study in the afternoon. So let us begin to worship.
To God be the glory. Would you please stand and join us? Begin this morning by professing and praising the name of Jesus and how much we love him, and celebrating the fact that we are the light, his light.
I'm sorry.
salt of the earth. And Lord, we have a mission to bless others because we have been blessed by you. We thank you, Father, for this Communion Sunday, when we can give to you both our tithes and our offerings, and also our benevolent offerings. As we come before you, Lord, receive these gifts from hearts filled with joy for following you, from hearts filled with joy for the blessings that you pour into our lives, and from hearts filled with joy because you are our God, our Savior, and the Holy Spirit that works in us and through us to be light, to be salt. Amen. Into his presence, whether it's at the beginning of the service or at this time of the bread and the cup, that we come into the presence of the most holy, wondrous, righteous, and only God. So as we take a breath, as Carrie and I take a breath, as you inhale, think of the Holy Spirit power that breathes into us life and love and wisdom and knowledge and grace. We pause just for a moment to reflect on who he is. And he is awesome. There is no God. As we come into this space of communion, we also think of the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. I've said it before, but it's a perfect prayer. We cannot make it any better or improve upon it. We cannot humble as our own prayers are, unless they follow this guideline. We sometimes pray for the wrong things. We pray for ourselves above hallowing who God is, or we pray for what we want instead of what God has to give to us so freely and so wondrously. So as we recite these words, let them not be just from the root memory, but let them be from your heart. Imagine yourself in the place of his disciples who asked him, Lord, teach us to pray. John taught us how to pray. You teach us how to pray. So let us bow our heads now and recite from our heart, the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. help us to come forward today as Carrie leads us. Jesus also took the cup, and he told his disciples, though they could not understand, that it would wash them of their sins, and that forgiveness would be granted because of the blood, his blood. And we are forgiven our sins because of the cup and what it represents. Let us pray for the cup. Loving God, we praise and thank you for your love shown to us in Jesus Christ. We thank you for his life and ministry, announcing the good news of your kingdom and demonstrating its power by lifting up the downtrodden and healing the sick and loving the loveless. We thank you for his sacrificial death upon the cross for the redemption of the world and for raising him to life again as a foretaste of the glory we shall all share. We give you thanks for the cup, a symbol and reminder of your blood shed for our sins and a sign of your transforming love. Send your Holy Spirit, we pray, that we may be renewed into the likeness of Jesus Christ. We pray in his name and for his sake. Amen. Take your cup and drink. Showing the love of Jesus
down and depressed or when they're sad. And we can just be an ear that lets them talk. We can listen to people when they want us to clean and we pay attention and we go and do that job right away and then we're fine and we're loving. When your mom tells you to do something and what?
Listen.
And you listen, good. That's right, absolutely. But, you know, my cup says what? Joy, joy. Now, in a song, in a scripture, Jesus said, if you put your light under a bushel, what would it do? What would happen?
Cover it.
You would cover it. Nobody would be able to see, that won't stay on there very good. They wouldn't be able to see your light. Do you want to be, oh, thank you. Do you want to be that kind of person?
No.
No. But when we take it, you can turn it off and flip it up. When we keep our light burning bright, then we bring joy to ourselves and to other people. And we let them know that there is somebody up there and somebody in here that can give them that same joy. Amazing. That's what Jesus does. So let's have our prayer, and then you can go. And I'll turn this off for now. Dear Jesus.
Dear Jesus.
Thank you for being our light.
Thank you for being our light.
And thank you for letting us be the light for you.
May we never
put our light
under a bushel
and hide who you are
in
us
and through us
as we love other people.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. Okay.
Scripture reading is from Matthew 5, verses 13 to 20. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Therefore, anyone who sets aside one of the least of these commands and teaches others accordingly will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. May God bless the reading of these words.
Salt and light. You are what? Not you will be. Not within you there is the potential, but you are the salt of the earth. You as an individual, you as the body of Christ of the First Baptist, you as the church in the world are the salt of the earth. You are set apart by God's grace, as you have been transformed by his grace. You are the light of the world. You have been appointed to bring light to dispel the darkness of the world. It
It is a sacred duty to go into the world, go into the mission field of our communities, to go and make disciples of all nations. It's about keeping our ears to the ground to hear what Christ is calling us to do as individuals and as a church. It's about realizing that salt has little influence while it sits in a salt shaker, waiting to be used. Christians sitting alone in the comfort of their homes are unlikely to make a difference to those outside their door. However, once it is mixed in the right proportions into our food, the food transforms. It's only as we rub elbows with others, both Christians and non-Christians, do we have the opportunity to bring the flavor of Christ into the lives of those that we know and those we meet. Beware, though, that we stay alert so that we impart Christ's flavor into them rather than allowing them to impart a secular flavor into our lives. There is always, always that danger. You see, it's as a church and as a community that we best embody the salt and the light of Christ that Scripture is talking about. There is no one individual which embodies salt or light. It is about the whole community which is needed to exemplify the resemblance of salt and light. Salt needs the food to improve it. Light needs a poorly lit environment to enhance its brightness. We are the church, and we go into a world which loves the darkness rather than the light, for their works are evil, wrote John. We may say we are few in number. This is no matter, for just as a few grains of salt can make a big difference in the food, so also a few faithful Christians can make a big difference in the world around them. However, Jesus does go on to say that salt can lose its taste. So we must be on guard not to lose our spiritual zest and become complacent. We must not be tempted to give too much respect to those values by the world and too little to the values found in God's word. When we do that, we cease to be salt and become good for nothing but to be cast out and trampled underfoot, under the feet of those that would do that. As for Jesus' way of speaking, which was a usual way of using images, he selected some in this so that his listeners could relate to in everyday life. Salt, cities, light, they're everyday realities that become the groundwork for challenging us all toward righteousness, which is found in the law and the prophets. In verse 16, Jesus says we ought to reflect the goodness of God by being a city on a hill or an uncovered lamp. In this way, others would see God's goodness through us and be grateful to God. Our good works do not belong to us, for we are not the source of such good works. In fact, we are the conduit for the light of God. We point to this greater reality, which is beyond ourselves. So we are in fact signposts, lighting up the goodness of God as an overflow of God's call and grace in our lives. We point the way to God's righteousness, not our own. We may serve as the light in the world, but the conduit for our light is not us or our achievements, though they might make us proud and boastful, because ultimately they belong to our Father in heaven. There are people who boast in their good works. We've known them, we've met them. Some believe their good works will get them into heaven's gate. But I want to emphasize that this becomes a problem when we boast in our good works to bring the glory to ourselves and not to God. When we witness or give testimony of what has happened in our life, which is wondrous and good, and we give the glory to God for our works, well, this is not highlighting us, but it's highlighting God's grace. It brings hope to those hearing that they too can experience God's grace in their life. Jesus calls us to be salt and to serve in a way that we were designed to serve. If we are boasting in our works to bring glory to ourselves, we lose our saltiness. We are in fact then placing our light under a basket. And the darkening of the light, the loss of the saltiness, has eternal consequences. We are instead to be a transformative justice in our world. We are to be righteousness. We are to be watching the Beatitudes and learning from them as they point out God's favor toward humanity, as opposed to the demands of Rome. Being a peacemaker was difficult to obey in the first century under Rome. But God grants them the favor to accomplish this. The price, though, is high. Our whole life, our will, our wants, and our needs are demanded if we decide to follow the call of Jesus. Jesus teaches us not only what the kingdom of God is, but he also teaches us who we are and what our lives in this new realm look like, tasty, and lit up. We who follow Jesus don't sit back in our easy chair, handed an abundant life, or just go out and tell others about the abundant life we have. Jesus is talking about a life, our life, which will make a difference for others in this world. So our abundance should overflow to lead them to a life of abundance in Christ. This goes back to our testimony about how God has moved in our life. And it's all about our purpose. We are the flavor-filled nourishment that adds salt to the lives around us. We are the light that makes plain the justice of the kingdom of God. We are meant to exist not for ourselves, but for others. We can only fulfill our purpose when we are used, poured out, lit up, and ready to expose the dark corners of the world with the light of Christ. We have it so easy in today's world that we take these words of Jesus for granted. Both salt and light for us are easy commodities. Turn on a switch, lights go on. Go to the grocery store, pick up a box. Flavor my soup. In the first century, though, both of these were rare commodities, and they sustained life. Neither could be produced easily or on their own, as they are gifts of creation that required ingenuity to access. We need not worry where the sun is each day. We need not worry if our salt is pure or if we should be cautious because it may be mixed with a substance causing it to lose its ability to preserve. In Jesus' day, these two elements were precious because light was not at the tip of their fingers, and the tipping of a shaker would not preserve their food. The fact is that sometimes we may not even know whose life we are affecting by being salt and light. This is why our every moment of every day must be called out life, displaying the attitudes of Jesus. I want to relate a story that exemplifies this for us. On October 22, 1988, Oral Hershinger was on the Johnny Carson show. He was a pitcher for the Los Angeles Dodgers, and they had just won the World Series. Oral had been named the most valuable player. One of the TV shows about the series showed him in the dugout just before the ninth inning started. He was leaning against the wall and his lips were moving. So when, as a guest on the Tonight Show, Johnny Carson asked him what he had been saying. "I wasn't saying anything," Oral responded. "Well then, tell us what you were doing." Finally, Oral replied, "I was singing." Johnny said, "You were singing? I didn't know you were a singer. Come on, let's hear it." And Oral said, "Nah, I don't want to. And the audience clapped and said, yeah, let's hear it, woo! Finally, Oral Hershinger started to sing. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. And Johnny Carson was speechless. The whole audience was dead silent. Then one person stood up and started clapping. And soon the whole audience joined in applause. You see, this was Oral's way of saying, Lord, the only reason I'm the most valuable player is because you're the most valuable God. You're the one who gave me my ability. You're the reason why my life has been so blessed. I respect you, Lord, and I love you. Now, I don't know if an audience would start clapping in today's world. But it should not matter to a follower of Christ. I have to tell you that sometimes I wonder if the sermons preached fill us with just more knowledge, but that knowledge impedes our action in the world. If so, then it becomes knowledge without purpose. All too often we have information about Jesus, about God and the Holy Spirit to share, but that's as far as it goes. Jesus reminds us that knowledge about God cannot exist as simply knowledge. It's not enough to know about God. As disciples, we have to do the activity of God in the world. We are called to live out our identity as salt and light. Knowledge without action prolongs the existence of racism in our world, and poverty, and abuse. Knowledge without action continues to oppress, to marginalize, to overlook. As salt and light, we might just be the salt that stings, or the light that exposes what we do not want to see. What Jesus needs from us is a righteousness that is above the scribes and Pharisees. So, what if Jesus' intention was for us to imagine and live a life of righteousness that makes the kingdom of heaven possible? No wonder then that Jesus gave his message to his disciples right at the beginning of their apostleship. In Matthew's Beatitudes, what is at stake is action for God. God is righteous. He sees the poor in spirit. Discipleship is not just about a certain way of being in the world, but it's the ultimate way of being in the world. Matthew has high standards for discipleship. We would be good to heed this wisdom. The demands of discipleship are not for the lighthearted, but for the deeply devoted. Salt, city, light. In these attributes, you and I will find our purpose. Let us prepare our hearts for prayer. have shone in Jesus, revealing unto us your holiness and our unrighteousness. Father, we regret this gap, yet we rejoice that you chased the darkness that kept it hidden from our eyes. By your light, we are both encouraged and condemned. We are reassured to see your face turned in our direction, bidding us to come unto you. But Father, we shudder at the sight of us turning our backs on you, resisting the light that could mirror your glory. We thank you, O God, for leaving your light in the world, even though we have not always heeded your summons to become the light of the world. Instead of illuminating your character sometimes, Lord, we have blurred it. You have commanded us to love you with all our being, but as at times we have transferred our love to the pigeonhole of religion. You have commanded us to love our neighbors as ourselves. But Father, sometimes we've been too preoccupied with ourselves to find them. You have called us to be peacemakers. Yet we have set up defenses with our fears and our fortunes. You have summoned us to be wall breakers, yet we have supported the wall makers with our silence and our sympathy. We have seen the light, but we have refused to walk in it. Yet we long, O Lord, to keep your law and to do your will. We ask forgiveness for our rebellion, not merely for the sake of the joy we have denied ourselves, but, Father, also for the joy we have denied others. Keep ever before us the needs of the world into which you sent Jesus, and for whose sake he gave himself to the uttermost. Let us feel its pain as our own, seek its good as our own, and work for its transformation in the name and spirit of him who came into this world not to condemn, but to redeem. Father, we listen to your word. Let its message illuminate our minds that we may, as Jesus, be and do as he willed. Let us quicken our hearts, Father, that we may love as Jesus loved. Let its power speed our steps that we may do as Jesus did. Father, we pray for those that are sick amongst us. We pray for those that might be grieving, or those that might be struggling with some aspect of life. Challenges come to us, Lord, in many different ways. But we know that as we walk with you, that you are a light to our path. And that as we follow you, Lord, we can see and find the way through all that we might encounter. We thank you that you are the light of the world. And we thank you, Jesus, that you came to shed your light into our hearts. Help us, Lord, to be the people you have called us to be. Father, we also pray for Ray, who fell at work this week and has injured himself. We pray that you would bless him with healing power, Lord. We pray these things as we come into your presence, Lord, that you would bring healing to each one of us where we might need it as well. For you are the God that makes us whole. You are the God that lights us up. And we thank you and we praise you.
Would you please stand?
decision, and our strength is not equal to this task. But you, O Lord, are a merciful God. You give light to those who walk in darkness, and you grant strength to those who carry heavy loads. As we return to the workday world, let us see your light before us and feel your strength within us. Amen and amen.